everyone! I am Tacet, and today I'm going to be going over the Gems of War. That's a rap event in which the Tutankhatmun has been added to the game. So, I am still on my trip, unfortunately. We will have slightly weirder audio, probably sound a little bit more mechanically. Should hopefully work out, but I don't, of course, have my normal setup. Anyways, hope you all are enjoying the holidays and Happy New Year's, as this is probably the last video that's coming out before the end of New Year's, and we'll be back around the 6th and should have some videos to go over the new things that are coming out this Friday, like the new Hero class and new Mythic, of course. But for now, let's go and get into the event. So as far as the troop, it is towards the more useless side. Pretty decent trade stone, though. Green Blues is an epic, so you can get them for 200 each. So if you want to go and stock up on this, it's a really good one to go and end up accumulating. As far as this troop, not so much. It curses and death marks the strongest enemy, and then ends up destroying 30 gems of one of their mana colors. You can end up getting quite a bit of mana accumulation this way. However, the curse plus death mark is kind of a weird mechanic. Like, basically, this is going to be like a Merilith without the damage, but putting the damage off of luck base. So it could have some potential. Biggest thing that it's really going to be used for is with magic buff. Without magic buff, I don't feel like it's going to be used much. It's very similar to that of, oh, what's his name? Thrall from Darkstone. That one purple troop that destroys a lot of gems, but doesn't really get too much value, but he does it for such a low mana cost that he can kind of get away with it. That's somewhat what this troop does, in that it's set up similarly, a high gem destroy. This will allow it to accumulate a lot of mana, and it's only really going to be useful with magic. And the fact that it is 20% and still has that low, I believe even Merilith has a higher base value, Thrall has a higher base value. There's already things that have a higher base value that I feel like are going to make this useless. Also, Egg Thief being able to go and max out her destroy so quickly is also going to probably make it useless. But Curse plus Death Mark, it's not a bad mechanic in the sense that it can be strong. You can literally instant kill. Basically, what Curse does is it'll make the Death Mark last twice as long, so it'll take 5%, 10%, 15%, and so forth to cleanse off, rather than the normal 10%, 20%, 30%, and so forth. So, in that regard, it's going to be okay, but it's just going to probably be too luck-based compared to other options that already exist, which will basically make it not useful. Similar to Egg Thief, it does also have Stealthy, so it does have that going for it, something that I don't think Thrall has, if I'm not mistaken, but that's one of the things that makes Egg Thief better. But compared to an Egg Thief, I really don't personally feel like this will ever get used, or so situationally that you'll barely use it. Well, so that's a really funny image to have for it. But anyways, that's that thing. It's an interesting utility troop. I would definitely say it has some use, though compared to just using a key Egg Thief team, I don't feel like it has much at the moment, personally. Other than that, we have 500 gold for Battle Crashers. This, you'll be able to get an extra 500 gold whenever you end up killing them in PvP and Explorer. They are in Explorer as well, so do be mindful of that if you just want to go grind Explorer, which I feel like is pretty much the meta these days, given tokens and everything. So just go grind out Explorer and you'll get a bunch of extra gold for the next few days. Not sure exactly when this is ending to, because it says 4 days now. I assume that's still like the first or second, but yeah, we'll have some amount of time to go and end up killing those out. And other than that, of course, we have Blue Tower of Doom this week, which we'll be going over in a second there. And other than that, 10% to all Kedar and 10% to all Undead, which is pretty much the entirety of the kingdom. And while you're probably not going to be using this too much this week, or really at all for the most part, if you do want to try using it and messing around with it, you do gain an additional 40 souls per PvP and Explore. However, this isn't really worth it, because Dragon Soul and Ferris Ra are much better soul farming options, and Soul Forge has some pretty shiny things this week. But first, keys. Are they worth using? Yes. They are to the degree that Ferris Ra is within the Kedar drop table. As far as Kedar drop table, all we have to do is go over to Kingdoms and drag over to Kedar. And if you click Show All, if you don't already own everything, it'll end up showing everything that is underneath Kedar. As far as valuable drops, there are a few. Azurus is a little bit noteworthy, in that if you don't have a Ferris Ra, it is the best soul farming troop that you can slot there that isn't Ferris Ra, in that he has Necromancy, which is pretty standard, a 50% soul gain. However, it also has a plus one purple onto that, which works really good into various Dragon Soul teams, and is the best option of anything that has Necromancy to synergize in those teams, aside from Ferris Ra. So it's a pretty good option in that regard. Its ability is pretty useless, but you mostly just use it for its trait. Bone Dragon used to be good, pretty relevant these days, but still fun to mess around with, in theory. But the only other really good thing here is two other things. Keeper of Souls. Keeper of Souls is basically like Apothecary, Valkyrie, all those kind of things that have a single convert. Except instead of being able to do it for a color, he does it for skulls. He has a lot of control over the board. when he can end up doing this, has won the higher skull creations as well, depending on how much of a color you have on the board, and is one of the more controlled overall versions of a skull spammer, so really good option in that regard. I don't feel like I use it too much in this current state of the game, but it's definitely not a bad option to have your hands on, especially if you're currently lacking skull spam options of any kind, which you definitely can be earlier on in the game. And other than that, the main thing you'd even want to bother opening event keys for pretty much entirely is Ferish Ra. Ferish Ra is probably particularly noteworthy in that out of every mythic in the game, he's pretty much the only one that you still get value for up to four. Normally, you only really need two, so don't really bother going past two if you already have two. However, he theoretically still gains value even at three or four because his final trait does stack. He gains an additional 150% souls from every single battle he does, and that stack. So two of them will be 300%. And unlike some things in this game, it does stack for the full percent. So you have two of them, that's 300%. You have three of them, that's 450%. And if you somehow run four of them, if you feel like doing that, that is 600%. Obviously, more often than not, you just tend to run it with two with a Dragon Soul and some kind of support troop. But and that would end up giving you 300,000. But pretty much any amount of Ferish Ra's is beneficial, obviously beyond four, because you would never need more than four. But yeah, go up to two. You can get them in event keys, and it's definitely something to consider getting at minimum one of, especially ever since they added a new meddling system into the game. As of a couple patches ago, that ends up requiring a lot of souls, at minimum 60,000 per troop, and that can add up pretty quick. And Ferish Ra, even in the current state of the game, in various teams with a double Ferish Ra teams, can still reach around 50,000 souls per hour, give or take a little bit, depending on your bonuses and other things. But definitely a solid 40,000 per hour, if nothing else. So definitely get your hands on it. It is wonderful to have if you don't already have. Other than that, you mostly just get some other copies of some things that are kind of okay, like Skeleton, Wall Bones. These things, obviously, really low rarity. You wouldn't necessarily need to go and open event keys particularly to get, but having them a little bit higher isn't all horrible. Same as Feral Hound, if you somehow haven't gotten that for Bounty Hunter yet, is one of the more better utilities for his barrier and everything. I believe he's actually still the... Actually, no, there's a few barriers now, but he at one point was the only barrier for Bounty Hunter. But regardless, Ferish Ra is the main thing. Keeper Soul is more so the secondary thing. Anyways, that's the Soul Forge. As far as Tower of Doom, of course, plays out the normal way. You can use, you have to use a pure blue team with your weapon being whatever you want. And you just go through a bunch of rooms, communicate with your guild, what rooms you end up doing. I believe my guild is communicating that somewhere here. Do they not have a message? There's a message. So you can just go and have some kind of way to mention it to your guild and then just have all of them set up. And just being able to figure out what each of these are, just having something to denote every single one of the rooms, and just report back every single unlock room to your guild, as well as any of the useful rooms. The useful rooms, of course, being Power, Heroism, Lucky, and Fireball, and somewhat Haste, depends if you want to go for it or not. It's basically a sigil, but if you end up finding a Vow Raven, it gives you value. However, if you don't find a Vow Raven, it basically gives you no value, though I guess it theoretically brings you slightly closer to Vow Raven. Of course, Leaderboard's still useless. Similarly, the weapon's still useless. Still, the only valuable weapons as far as Doom weapons are concerned are all of the Doom weapons that end up creating Doom Skulls. This one is the same as the one that we've been getting quite a few of recently, where they just create some of the color and the skulls. Same general premise as a few other tomes that we've been getting. They're all pretty pointless. However, they are tomes, so I guess in that regard, they can, I believe, gain 8 magic total off of some classes. So they're okay in that regard, but tomes overall, not really anything too powerful under them. And compared to the normal Doomskull creating AoE weapons, they're just not worth using. And you might still want to get it for completionist purposes, but it still currently stands that the 6 Doom weapons that convert into Doomskulls are the only valuable ones. So consider that. Other than that, guild stuff. As far as things that we're having going on this week, we have, New Year's, of course, tomorrow. So Happy New Year's, everyone. Other than that, we have the Faction Assault for tomorrow as well. That will be for the Sea of Sorrows, one of the harder pure factions to do, so it's probably potentially worth doing. I won't be since I'll be away, but I think the next time it rolls around, I might actually do pure faction 4. It's one of the harder kingdoms to actually do pure faction 4, possibly even the hardest, depending on how you define it, mostly because of the amount of true damage that's on the final battle. But that'll be a blue-brown restriction, so it should be pretty easy to do normally. If you're just running Truffle, if you're just running Irongut, there's quite a few options that you have under blue-brown. You can even use those new Vespera teams, though that might be a little bit slow. But you definitely don't lack options. Wednesday, we will be having the Sphinx, if I'm not mistaken, that is Kedar bonus. This Thursday, we have nothing. And after that, we'll end up having a new hero class this Friday, as well as a new mythic this Friday, because it'll, of course, be the first Friday of the month and the first Friday or the first mythic of the year as well. So we'll have all that coming in. And we almost have every hero class in the game. If I'm not mistaken, we're only missing four, and that will be one of those four. So we'll have that very soon, TM. Other than that, Soul Forge. So what's in Soul Forge this week? We have ourselves some very shiny things. I thought they were going to do this, and I was almost going to pre-make the thumbnail to say something soul-related. I ended up opting for not doing it, but for whatever reason, I felt like they were going to do Dragon Soul plus Ferris Rod this week. I'm not sure if they deliberately did this, or if it was just pure luck that it happened to fall this way. But yes, Dragon Soul and Ferris Rod are both craftable this week, and for anyone who's played the game for a while knows that this is very, very relevant, as that's basically the entirety of your soul farming team. Dragon Soul I advise getting at literally any point in the game. If you have 800 diamonds and you don't own Dragon Soul, go buy it right now, because he is that valuable. He's probably the only legend that is always 100% worth crafting if you don't currently have it. There's probably only three that count under that category. Dragon Soul, Yao Guay, and Queen Titania. And of those three, Dragon Soul is definitely the most relevant. And it's mostly because two reasons. One is he has an absurdly high damage from an early game perspective and mid game perspective, as well as he's one of the best soul farmers in the game. As far as his capability, explode some gems. That's a lot lower earlier on in the game. However, his damage stays consistent. His base damage is 11, regardless of how high your stats are. And it goes all the way up to 20 if you have four dragons on your team. So that's pretty substantial. Obviously, 20 this late in the game is going to do almost nothing. However, 20 damage when you're in early game or mid game is like few-shotting the entire enemy team. So that's pretty potent. Not to mention, if you can three-shot the enemy team, he gains 15 souls every time. So to max out your 40 soul capacity, you would just have to go and cast three times. And that's applicable even if you have Ferris Rods, because those end up multiplying on it. So regardless of how much multiplier you have, if you're using one Ferris Rod, two Ferris Rods, some amount of Necromancy, whatever combo you're running to soul farm with this guy, you'll still be able to go get the full amount of souls within three single casts. So really, really potent in that regard. One of the quicker ways to get to max souls while still winning quickly. So great option to have. Highly advise crafting it. Trades aren't really too useful, but if anything, that's almost a good thing, since you aren't dependent on having to trade it as an early game player. So you won't really need to worry about that as much. And other than that, of course, Ferris Ra. While he's in the event key drop table, you can also get him in the Soul Forge this week. So if you want to go and guarantee craft one, if you don't want to go waste your event keys, or if you just used all of them and were able to get lucky, you can just simply throw 4,000 diamonds and get a guarantee Ferris Ra. It is pretty important to get this. However, it's only important if you're actually going to soul farm. He isn't really used in anything other than soul farming in the current state of the game for the most part. So if you're not planning on soul farming, you can still kind of wait a little bit. However, given that it's both a Kedar event and a craftable with him and so forth, it's probably going to be a while before another Ferris Rod pops up again. Probably months, if not longer, so do be wary of that. However, if you're not planning on soul farming anytime soon, owning him won't really help you at all. Because, obviously, he's only helping you. That bonus only applies if you're specifically using him on your team. And if you're specifically soul farming, which generally these days you do it on Explore 1, 2, or 3. You just quick kill it with Dragon Soul, or normally Explore 2. You quick kill it with 3 kills off a Dragon Soul cast. Use normally like Dragon Soul, Double Ferris Ra, Umberwolf, or any kind of similar combination. You can use Purple Storm off a hero. You can use any of the Necromancy troops if you don't have the Ferris Ra's, or if you don't have a second Ferris Ra, and ends up working out pretty nice and gets a high soul rate in the game. So worth considering, and only if you ever want to go and grind souls. Only other thing that's kind of worth it here, Infernus. Infernus is a pretty good overall damage source. Pretty much constant 3 damage per turn to the entire enemy team off its extra turn. Still the best burn all in the entire game. That's pretty much never going to change since he does off extra turn. Gets to summon a Firestorm, which is pretty relevant as he gets to both explode and create a Firestorm into himself, which very few troops have the capability of both doing damage, a board clear, and a storm, all for its own benefit. And it's one of the only few troops in the entire game that has all that in combination, so still pretty good overall benefit. I feel like he's starting to fall off a little bit as of recently, as stats are starting to get slightly higher, because he's not good against higher stat content. He's mostly good against content that is similar to your stats, or ever so slightly above, or obviously slightly below. But once you start getting too high, he does start to, of course, lose his benefit. He's obviously not you wouldn't use him in Delves or anything like that. He doesn't upscale like a Megavore or something else would. But he's pretty good against PvP, mostly used for pretty much exclusively PvP and Guild Wars these days in the current state of game. Other than that, I guess Megavore is somewhat worth mentioning, as I literally actually just mentioned him right there. On paper, his traits are like some of the best in the game, in theory, but it's so luck-based that it ends up making it not as good. He has some HP every extra turn. impervious, which is obviously good on anything. And he has an 8% chance to kill every single extra turn. The biggest issue with this is this 8% can be so inconsistent that some battles you won't get it a single time, and other battles you get it like three times. And for that reason, it's a little bit inconsistent if you're using it for like Guild Wars and stuff. Still usable for that kind of things, but still it's it doesn't score as well due to how its damage gets calculated, because instant kills do not count as damage in Guild Wars. And you really want to use it for delves, and given that we got Iron Gun and stuff like that, for the same mana cost of what he can do, it's not really just worth going for that. He does get to eliminate all armor. However, this could almost be a bad thing. If you're using a Mang team, you can't use it with Mang, you can't use it with Yasmin. A lot of really good weapons are actually dependent on enemy's armor, even if you're using something like a Tesla or something, that's obviously dependent on the armor as well. So that ends up making a couple teams that are pretty meta not actually possible to be used. However, of course, tearing all armor is quite a bit of damage. If you're up against higher content, like 200 armor, boom, you just did 800 damage plus in a single cast. However, in many other situations, it doesn't help as much. It's very situational, but still 4x armor tier, still the only thing in the game that has it. So somewhat relevant for that, though it's lower on the priority list as far as crafts. But between the two mythics that are available there, never mind, Black Halconia is one. I was thinking it was Merlantis for a second. Never mind. It's a Merfolk, it's not Merlantis, though. You kind of think it would be, but never mind. So anyways, next thing. So, weapons. As far as weapons are over here, we have ourselves the Doomstone. Of course, this is what you can just get within the event itself. I would not advise actually buying into it. You should just go and get it with gems if you're going to bother getting it. Otherwise, don't get it at all. Other than this, we have the Undead Creation thing. This is the double effect, and it just happens to be for Undead. I don't believe there's anything that it really currently works for. It's also a really unfortunate color of brown-red, and obviously there's a lot of good brown-red options out there that would make that less desirable to really use on Hero. Main one being Mang and Earth's Fury, of course. I mean, Wait, what was it again? Why did I forget its name? But the one that can tear armor and give your attack to all your allies. But anyways, other than that, we have ourselves the Doomed Help as well. You can end up crafting that. Another useless one that's not really ever going to be relevant. It's just one of the life gains. They mentioned they were going to buff these in the past. However, they still haven't done that, so I wouldn't hold your breath on that yet. So I'd probably just hold off on this. They're pretty expensive to craft Doomed weapons, and it's pretty low priority. However, if you want it for completion purposes, that is one of the other ones that is here. And it's also kind of hiding on us, but we do have the Bone Shield over here, as well as Withering Touch. Withering Touch, gosh, this thing is an ancient weapon, but Withering Touch, if you want to get it, has a little bit of a life steal into a mana drain. Not really the greatest, but it is available. Other than that, we have ourselves the Bone Shield. This is basically the same thing as the other weapon, except for Undead. It ends up doing it for all of Kedar. So, honestly, I'd probably say the Undead one is a little bit better if you're going to go one or the other. So, if you're choosing between Bone Shield or the Gauntlet, I'd probably go with the Gauntlet, just because I feel like it has a little bit more applicable on this, just because it Undead span way further, obviously, than Kedar, if you're going to go bother doing team synergies with it into the future. So probably the Dead Gauntlet is the one you'd want to go for there. Also, it is Earth's Fury, right? That's going to bother me forever now. Let's see. It is definitely Earth's Fury, and I'm just going crazy thinking that it's not. Yes, it is Earth's Fury. Why did I think it was not Earth's Fury? Okay, I was right the first time. But anyways, let's go and go over some teams now that we went over that. So here are several teams. I just want to go and show real quick for everything related to this week. So Blue Doom, do keep in mind that the faction tomorrow is also blue. So every single thing that I'm showing here, you theoretically could also run for the event, oddly enough, for tomorrow, for when you go do the faction event. So do be wary of that if you do want to go do that. However, of course, when you're doing Blue Doom, you have a little bit more restriction in that you can only use blue, and weapon can still be any color. Though in this particular instance, we did do it with the Scepter. You can also go Mountain Crusher. I'm just so used to using this thing with Scepter. But you can end up Anu Sceptering into Shibanu. This will end up giving you all of the, ideally, most or all of the mana that you would need for her. You're going to have Enchant and stuff most likely too during Dooms if you even bought the first pack, so you already have that to help get mana up a little bit quicker. Basically, to spam Vespera, she'll go and synergize off of all the blues on your team in order to go and create more blues, because she does it per instance. You choose one ally, and then the other two go on at random, and then you can end up getting a bunch of spawn if everyone's the same color. So you can one of the nice benefits of having an Interceptor or any blue weapon here is you can go and target your first slot if you want to tank it up, or you can simply go for the Winter Imp and buff it up. Winter Imp is available right now in Glory Gem Guild and VIP chest as well, though you probably want to wait till this Friday if you don't have it in order to go get the new mythic. But it is going to be able to go and get a nice amount of true damage, and unlike all the other imps, or similar to all the other imps, it gains 8 magic every single time it matches a gem. However, since it does true damage rather than physical damage like the other 5 imps, it gains a lot more value than any other imp from gaining this, since 8 magic, obviously that's true damage, is better than 8 magic that is physical damage. So, overall, the absolute best imp, and works really good in Shibana teams. A little bit towards the slower side, but if you're struggling at any point, it's a pretty free win if you don't have other options. Of course, one of the more standard options is just run standard Irongut team. Nothing really too special here. The team that's been meta for about a year now, it's probably the most relevant thing of this year in general, is just the whole Irongut kind of team setup. But he's been very relevant ever since he came out a year ago and is definitely still relevant now. So if you want to go just quick kill with everything with that, get your Devourer. Once you get over 100 attack, you get a guarantee Devourer automatically. And of course, in things like Tower of Doom as well as Delves, if you're using it for either of them, you have higher attack than you normally would due to in Delves having the faction bonus from your Horde. And in the case of Tower of Doom, you have it because of those boons that you get from whenever you find those scrolls whenever you're going through the Delve rooms. So regardless, you're going to have a higher attack than normal when doing these upscaling pieces of content anyways, which will just make him even higher. And of course, you can set your attack even higher off of tokens as well, or medals, I should say, if you already don't have enough attack to be sufficient. Other than that, if you're looking for something really, really ridiculously cheap, this is super easy to get, Mang. I believe it's that 23 brown red hero mastery. That has to be your the level up mastery to be mindful of that. And you can easily just do a Mang, use it as Titan, have barrier every single brown so that you can keep barriering up. And then you just keep barriering over and over and over again, taking browns. You use Mang to tear their armor to gain a bunch of attack. And then you use spam Dwarven Gate. The interesting thing about triple Dwarven Gate is you can cast it 3 times. Once you have a 15 amount of mana, 10 on this one and 5 on the second one, you can just keep spamming. You use 5 mana to all allies. And you'll basically have an infinite loop armor gain for these, as well as barrier all other allies, which will help keep your hero alive and basically just kill through everything. In the case of Tower of Doom, one nice thing about this team that you wouldn't be able to do in something like Delves is if you accidentally lose troops, which is definitely possible potentially, you won't really have to worry about it because you're going to revive completely every single time. So unlike in Delves, when you would do that, you don't need to worry about it in Tower of Doom. So if you accidentally lose one of these gates or something like that, it's not going to be the end of the world because that would ruin the loop otherwise. However, when doing it in Tower of Doom, every single time you end up doing another battle, it resets your team. So this ends up working out pretty decently. Not the best of options, obviously. However, this is literally 3 commons with a weapon that you get automatically for free at a really low level. So at minimum, that should be able to help carry you through a good majority of it. Could theoretically even go all the way if you play it carefully enough. So really cheap option to go and work with. Not advised, though, if you have better options. Other than that, I mentioned soul farming. Here's going to be one in the description that you can just copy-paste. It's the strongest one, Dragon Soul, Ferris Raw, Umberwolf. The replacements for this team is, there's unfortunately no replacement for Dragon Soul. However, he's in Soul Forge right now for only 800, so that's highly advised getting. There's no replacement for Dragon Soul, but everything else is a replacement. Double Ferris Raw, if you only have one Ferris Raw because you couldn't get another one off of Vent Keys or off of crafting another one, you can simply put an Azurus there. If you don't have Azurus, which you would have gotten off of Vent Keys as well, you can simply put literally anything with Necromancy in the game. The cheapest Necromancy is, I believe, still Warlock, which is a rare. It gets off his second trait, so you can easily go get that. And if you need a replacement for Umberwolf, if you don't have one or if you don't have them fully traded, you can use Hero with a Purple Storm. Any hero with Purple Storm, I believe they get it at level 20, any of them with Purple Storm. I know Necromancer has it. I forget a few of the other ones, but anything with Purple Storm on hero will be able to go and do the exact same thing. You could theoretically do it with Red Storm too if you weren't using Azurus. You just need to change your banner accordingly, of course. But it's normally just better to do it with Purple, especially if you're using any amount of Ferris Raw or any amount of Azurus, as it would increase your amount of Purple. And sometimes as a backup, you do the yellow to purple convert that he has in order to go and gain some additional Purple mana occasionally. Other than that, Sea of Sorrows, of course. We have Sea of Sorrows for the Tuesday event. You can just run pretty standard Truffle, nothing really too special there. You have access to blue, and of course you can use any color weapon for it. So you can simply just go run Farsh Troll, Double King Gup Truffle, and Doomed Glaive. You can also run Mirage Queen there if you want to be pure blue in that sense. You can even run that for Tower of Doom, of course, if you so choose. You can run Farsh Troll, Double King Gup Truffle, or literally just attack the team, or use a Mirage Queen in the last slot. So you have that as an option too. Most of these will have overlap both ways, since it's a pretty similar restriction to both of them. Similarly, I even just literally copy-pasted this one, though it's worth mentioning again, that of course you can just iron gut to higher levels. You gain even more attack in that of Delves, as far as base attack, due to your Horde level, and even now more so that you can upgrade Kingdoms in order to give a 25 or 50% bonus to your overall Horde bonus, which makes it go even higher. But as soon as he gets his first attack, he's pretty much good to go more often than not. And other than that, we have ourselves the Pier faction. So, of course, if you want to go and Pier faction, we have ourselves the double Hammer Claw with Sea Witch and the Deep King. This is mostly to go and tank it out with a 50% score reduction, and then you can end up going and using Sea Witch in order to keep buffing up in order to not die. And you basically just have the second one there to not as a backup. And you could go double Sea Witch, though this other Deep King is mostly just for a little extra bonus and to give yourself a little bit of extra attack. Doesn't really do too much, but it's better than having just another Sea Witch there in most situations. However, it is worth considering running double Sea Witch. I personally have not run Pure Faction for this place yet. Under 500 is one of the more annoying ones. But it's either this or try double to Hammer Claw with double Sea Witch. One of the two should end up working out and end up killing it through. But anyways, guys, that'll wrap it up for this video. Again, I hope you all have a happy New Year's. Again, I'll be back on the 6th, the night of the 6th. I should be back in with our normal format as normal. And this Friday should have some stuff going out as well for the newer content. And yeah, let's go from there. So again, hope you all have a wonderful holiday. I'll catch you guys soon. And thank you all so much for watching. Have a wonderful New Year's. Goodbye, everyone.